Hello everyone, welcome back. Today we are going to finish up our discussion of De Verbum with the very last chapter. The last chapter is chapter 6, Sacred Scripture in the Life of the Church. So, stick around. Like I said, this is the very last chapter in Dei Verbum. It is articles 21 through 26, and it goes over salvation, scripture, salvation, the life of the church. Article 21. The church has always venerated the divine scriptures just as she venerates the body of the Lord, since especially in the sacred liturgy, she unceasingly receives and offers to the faithful the bread of life from the table both of God's word and of Christ's body. She has always maintained them and continues to do so together with sacred tradition as a supreme rule of faith, since as inspired by God and committed once and for all to writing, they impart the word of God himself without change and make the voice of the Holy Spirit resound in the words of the prophets and the apostles. Okay, scripture is venerated just as we venerate the body of Christ, the Eucharist, or it should be. This isn't always followed through in practice, but the book of the Gospels, have you ever noticed they process it up during Mass? At the very beginning, it's processed up, and then it gets read at the pulpit. It's not processed out because during the Mass, we receive the Word of God, Christ himself, into our bodies through the Holy Communion, and we process the Word of God out. So the Word of God is processed in and out in two different ways. Pretty cool, right? Anyway, that's a bit off topic, but this Holy Scriptures are to be revered just as we revere the body of Christ. Therefore, like the Christian religion itself, all the preaching of the church must be nourished and regulated by sacred scripture. For in the sacred books, the Father who is in heaven meets his children with great love and speaks with them. And the force and power in the word of God is so great that it stands as the support and energy of the church, the strength of faith for her sons, the food of the soul, the pure and everlasting source of spiritual life. Consequently, these words are perfectly applicable to sacred scripture, for the word of God is living and active, from Hebrews. And it hath the power to build you up and to give you your heritage among all those who are sanctified, from Acts. Article 22. Easy access to sacred scripture should be provided for all the Christian faithful. That is why the church, from the very beginning, accepted as her own the very ancient Greek translation of the Old Testament, which is called the Septuagint, and she has always given a place of honor to other Eastern translations and Latin ones, especially the Latin translation known as the Vulgate. But since the Word of God should be accessible at all times, the Church, by her authority and with maternal concern, sees that the suitable and correct translations are made into different languages, especially from the original texts of the sacred books. And should the opportunity arise and the Church authorities approve, if these translations are produced in cooperation with the separated brethren as well, all Christians will be able to use them. Now we're talking about translations, and this is where some people are like, wait a second, the church didn't like translations in German, isn't that what Martin Luther said? First of all, the church had approved a German translation of the Bible, which was out long before Martin Luther, about 50 to 100 years before Martin Luther wrote his translation. There was already a German translation that was out. The printing press hadn't been invented yet, so it was very expensive to get the book, but there was a translation in the common language of the time available. So the church has never not wanted to show you the common language that's available to the people. The translations are always there, it's just a matter of if they were easily accessible. Without the printing press, it was really hard to, like, you know, handwrite the entire Bible in German multiple times so that everyone could have a copy. Martin Luther had a printing press that helped him out. So, yeah, there was a German Bible before Martin Luther. Important to note. Article 23. The bride of the incarnate word, the church, taught by the Holy Spirit, is concerned to move ahead towards a deeper understanding of the sacred scriptures so that she may increasingly feed her sons with the divine word. Therefore, she also encourages the study of the Holy Fathers of both East and West and of sacred liturgies. Catholic exegetes, then, and other students of sacred theology work diligently together and, using appropriate means, should devote their energies under the watchful care of the sacred teaching office of the Church to an exploration and exposition of the divine writings. This should be done so that as many ministers of the divine word as possible will be able effectively to provide the nourishment of the scriptures for the people of God, to enlighten their minds, strengthen their wills, and set men's hearts on fire with the love of God. The Sacred Synod encourages the sons of the Church and biblical scholars to continue energetically, following the mind of the Church with the work they have so well begun and with constant renewal of vigor. So we're called to keep studying Scripture. Scripture doesn't just like, we don't just read it and like know what it means automatically. Scripture study takes time, it takes learning what went into the Scripture and learning what's coming out of it and reading it in light of what the Church has, which is a lot of what the Church has, the Fathers, East and West, the liturgies. Reading the Scripture in light of all of that is just beautiful. And it says in here that we study Scripture for four different reasons. The first reason is to provide nourishments to the people of God. Reason number two is to enlighten the mind. Number three is to strengthen their will. And four is to set men's hearts on fire for the love of God. Those are all really awesome reasons to read Scripture, so we should probably all read more Scripture than we already do, or don't. Read Scripture, it's good for you. Article 24. Sacred theology rests on the written word of God together with sacred tradition as its primary and perpetual foundation. By scrutinizing in the light of faith all truth stored up in the mystery of Christ, theology is most powerfully strengthened and constantly rejuvenated by that word. For sacred scriptures contain the word of God, and since they are inspired, really are the word of God. And so the study of the sacred page is, as it were, the soul of sacred theology. The foundation of theology is the word of God, which is scripture and tradition. Very important. By the same word of scripture, the ministry of the word also, that is, pastoral preaching, catechetics, and all Christian instruction, in which the liturgical homily must hold the foremost place, is nourished in a healthy way and flourishes in a holy way. Scripture study is good for us. We should all definitely read more scripture. Because I know for myself, I probably don't read enough scripture. Just reading the daily readings, you could do more scripture. I do more sometimes, but I'm not consistently reading more scripture. And I know I should. Article 25. Therefore, all the clergy must hold fast to the sacred scriptures through diligent sacred reading and careful study, especially the priests of Christ and others such as deacons and catechists who are legitimately active in the ministry of the word. This is to be done so that none of them will become an empty preacher of the word of God outwardly, who is not a listener to it inwardly, since they must share the abundant wealth of the divine word with the faithful committed to them, especially in the sacred liturgy. The Sacred Synod also earnestly and especially encourages all the Christian faithful, especially religious, to learn by frequent reading of the divine scriptures the excellent knowledge of Jesus Christ. For ignorance of scriptures is ignorance of Christ. Therefore, they should gladly put themselves in touch with the sacred text itself, whether it be the liturgy, the rich in the divine word, or through devotional reading, or through instructions suitable for the purpose and other aids which, in our time, with approval and active support of the shepherds of the church, are commendably spread everywhere. And let them remember that prayer should accompany the reading of sacred scripture, so that God and man may talk together, for we speak to him when we pray, and we hear him when we read the divine saying. So we need to read and study scripture, and prayer should not be absent from that. Prayer is a big part of reading and studying scripture. Anyone who doesn't pray before they read or study scripture, or who isn't actively praying yet, they totally should. Prayer is important to scripture. It's a big part of it. It devolves on sacred bishops, who have the apostolic teaching to give the faithful entrusted to them suitable instruction in the right use of the divine books, especially the New Testament and above all the Gospels. This can be done through translations of the sacred texts, which are to be provided with the necessary and readily adequate explanations so that the children of the church may safely and profitably become conversant with sacred scripture and be penetrated with their spirit. So we should be studying scripture in a way that brings us closer to God. And under, like, the bishops are told here, you need to make sure that your diocese has the resources available to study scripture. There are great scripture study programs out there, and we just need to implement them all. I fail just as much as everyone else on this front. Furthermore, editions of the sacred scriptures, provided with suitable footnotes, should be prepared also for the use of non-Christians and adapted to their situation. Both pastors of souls and Christians generally should see to the wise distribution of these in one way or another. So scripture isn't just for those who are believing Catholics, it's for all Christians, and even those who don't believe can learn something from scriptures. They can come to know God, and that's just awesome. God is great. and are finally our very last article here, article 26. In this way, therefore, through the reading and study of the sacred books, the word of God may spread rapidly and be glorified, and the treasure of revelation entrusted to the church may more and more fill the hearts of men, just as the life of the church is strengthened through more frequent celebration of the Eucharistic mystery. Similarly, we may hope for a new stimulus for the life of the Spirit from a growing reverence for the Word of God, which lasts forever. The whole goal of Scripture is salvation. The whole goal of this document here, Dei Verbum, is to show us how Scripture can bring us to salvation, how salvation has been given to us through Scriptures, and that's pretty awesome. So we finished our talks on Dei Verbum. Please let me know what you'd like me to do next, because we're done with Dei Verbum, everybody. We made it through a document. Anyway, please let me know in the comments something you learned or any ideas you have for more videos. I will see you all next time. Please like and subscribe. God bless.